Good morning. You're listening to FloridaDaily.net, and I'm Kemp Haar. This morning, my guest in Dalton, Georgia, is Warner Braun, who's president of the Carpet and Rug Institute. Warner, how you doing?
Kemp, I'm doing great. It's been a long time. I'm glad to have an opportunity to talk with you again.
Yeah, I wanted to drive down here because I'd heard that this California caprolactam issue is not going away, and I wanted to get an update on that. So tell us what you know about that.
Well, we just recently, within the last month, met with OHEA, the Office of Environmental Hazard Health Assessment, and you know, we went out there prepared to talk about the impact that their proposed 2 microgram per cubic meter reference exposure limit was going to have on both the economy and jobs. To our surprise, they weren't interested in that data at all. Their position is that they are there to do only one thing, and that is provide safe exposure limits for the consumers in the state of California. Well, we think they're flat wrong on both counts. One, a 2 microgram per cubic meter level is absurd given everything we know about the toxicology. And when I say we, I don't mean just the Carpet and Rug Institute, but I mean federal EPA, NIOSH, the Europeans. Everyone is absolutely dismayed by what OHEA is recommending.
Mm-hmm. So let's back up and fill people in that may not realize that caprolactam is a critical ingredient in nylon 6, and I even think some forms of nylon 6-6. So, and what they're talking about is that when you talk about exposure levels, is this in the manufacturing process or in the finished product?
It's in the finished product. If it went the way that other volatile organic compounds have gone, it would be incorporated into 01350. And, of course, our Green Label Plus program is compliant with 01350. And that's important because a lot of organizations across the United States use Green Label Plus, but we might be in jeopardy because the wording is compliant with 01350, and if we choose not to adopt the recommendation that OHEA is planning on propagating next October, it might put our program in jeopardy and cause nationwide deselection of nylon 6-based carpet, not just in California.
So the resolution is to attempt to get them to adapt these federal levels of acceptance?
Well, I don't think we even need to go to 1,000 micrograms per cubic meter, which is what NIOSH is recommending in the workplace for a 30-year exposure and protecting sensitive populations. We could live with something substantively less than that, but, you know, the impact of what they're proposing is enormous, both in terms of capital requirements, operating costs, environmental implications. For example, we'd have to use about 80 million gallons of additional water, not to talk about the gazillion kilowatts of additional energy we would have to use. So it is a huge deal for this industry. And unfortunately, as I said earlier, they have no interest in that.
Hmm. Why do you think that they've tuned into this recently?
Well, I think part of it is that they have a process by which they review chemicals and the caprolactam issue came into their crosshairs of a chemical they wanted to look at, and this is where they came out.
Mm-hmm. Now, are you working with the California manufacturers of carpet as part of this process?
You know what? We just recently, within the last 2 weeks, completed a very comprehensive strategy, Kemp, that because of our limited degrees of freedom with OHEA, we decided we needed to look at other players that have part of this process under their umbrella. For example, we're getting to talk right now to the California Department of Public Health, who ultimately, in this process, are responsible for looking at the recommendations coming out of OHEA and then taking that, and they are the ones that then make the final recommendation on whether a new lower level needs to go into 01350 or the VOC standard. So that's one group we're beginning to talk to. And by the way, to finish the question, and when we reach out, a significant component of the people who would be doing the outreach will be our members in California.
Mm-hmm. I know that you have a new board member, Anthony Minetti, who is the head of Bentley Print Street, so I'm sure that's going to be a nice new relationship to use for this.
Yeah, he'll be an invaluable asset to us when we start really reaching out to some of these political figures.
We mentioned that you're starting a new year, and I'm just curious if you'd just give us a quick update on, other than this issue, which is monumental, but what are your other key issues for 2013 when we start thinking about the Carpet and Rug Institute?
Well, probably the largest issue, and it's one we've been working on for about the last 3 or 4 years, is extended producer responsibility legislation at the state levels. You know, California passed their AB 2398, and, you know, we're in the implementation phase of that. You know, and I'd say it's going along fairly well. But there are other states who have attempted to put through legislation, some of which is vastly more onerous than AB 2398. So we've been working very hard with probably 10 states to, you know, begin to educate their legislators about what we're doing on, with the voluntary program under CARE, and working as hard as we can to keep additional extended producer responsibility legislation from being promulgated. In addition to that, you know, we're continuing to work on our signature programs, Green Label Plus for volatile organic compounds. We're working still on seal of approval and getting that out there because, again, from everything we've learned and how the program is continuing to grow, it is having a positive impact in the marketplace with customer satisfaction related to their carpet cleaning and ultimately their carpet. There are a few other things that are on the horizon, unfortunately, again, in California. California has a piece of legislation they passed last year called Green Chemistries, in the process right now of writing the regulations that go with that legislation. And they're looking right now at possibly as many as 1,500 chemicals of concern. And so we're working very hard to, you know, understand what they are going to be trying to regulate, because there's a high probability that the carpet industry will be impacted somewhere in that process.
Mm-hmm. One thing you mentioned about the seal of approval programs, I know part of that is around vacuum cleaners, and with this big push toward ultra-soft carpet, there has been, I guess, a few issues that have been brought up around the type of vacuum cleaner it takes to run on super-soft carpet, right?
Well, there's been an issue that we've known about for a while, and that's with the so-called California-type shag. And, in fact, CRI did some research and published a white paper on the type of vacuum that works for that kind of a product. There is a new issue, which you have alluded to, that CRI is just starting to get engaged on. But from my conversation with Gary Asbury at Professional Testing Lab, it appears that there's probably going to be a fix to that issue as well. But that we're very early in that development.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Werner, it's great to spend time with you. Again, we've been talking to Werner Braun, who's president of the Carpet and Rug Institute, and you've been listening to Kempar and FloridaDaily.net.